Hejsan allesammans. Nu står jag inte bara här för att testa ljud, utan nu står jag här för att säga någonting. Varmt välkommen till Vetenskapens hus. Välkommen till dagens lunchföreläsning. Jag heter Zoe Lundqvist och jag är projektledare för universitetets offentliga arrangemang. Jag tror att klockan är 12 nu. Min mobil kraschade på morgonen så att jag upplever att min värld är lite förvirrad. Jag vet inte vad som är exakt längre. Men vi säger att klockan är 12 och därför börjar vi. Onsdagarna i det här huset, lunchtid, så presenterar vi en ganska breda allmänvetenskapliga frågeställningar. Allt ifrån hälsa till materialvetenskap. Det är lite grann för att få möjlighet att visa upp hela universitetets bredd. På torsdagarna presenterar vi en annan föreläsningsserie. Då är den lite smalare och handlar om den forskning vi bedriver inom ett område som vi kallar för intelligenta industriella processer. Men det är onsdag och därför så är det en av de mer allmänna föreläsningarna idag. Ni är mycket varmt välkomna att dela den här timmen ungefär med oss. Universitetet har som uppdrag att utveckla och förmedla och förvalta kunskap. Att utbilda och att forska. Som en konsekvens av det så vill vi också berätta om den verksamhet vi bedriver och dela med oss av vårt nätverk av kontakter. Det är en ganska naturlig uppgift för ett universitet. Och eftersom den här föreläsningen kommer att hållas på engelska så kommer jag att övergå till engelska nu och så kommer det att vara även fortsättningsvis av den här timmen. Today's subject is secondary use of personal information. What do they know? And the presenter today is Ali Padyab, a PhD student in information systems since about 4 years. So you are well on your way in your studies. When I tell my friends that what they don't know anything about me, that I don't want them to know on the net, they laugh really, really deep. Because they mean that I have no idea how the information that I share on the net are used. And that is what we are going to talk about today, net integrity and privacy. And you will present the research you are a part of in this field. So I know you will have a pleasant or frightening hour, and very welcome to you, Ali.
Okay, thank you very much, Zoe, for the presentation. It's always exciting to be presenting your research result to the public, to the citizens, and not only to the researchers, because this is part of our mission as the researchers, to share our result of research and raise awareness towards different things that we're researching and get some perhaps maybe feedback and see the impact of our research in the society. So this is one way for me. It's very interesting to show and present the result of my research to you. And basically, if I could raise your awareness about privacy in the internet just a little bit, then I would be very happy. As Zoe introduced, I'm a PhD student in information systems at Department of Computer Science, Electrical and Space Engineering. I've been a PhD student for around 4 years, and my research area is privacy within internet, especially within social media. So just to give an overview of what I will talk today, I will talk about the secondary use of information, what we share in the internet, and how makes it possible for others to use this kind of information. I will give some examples. I will go through some news that has been released, and I will discuss about the project that we did. It was called USEM project, and in that project we developed a tool where it made it possible to infer personal information from social media data. A short introduction about myself. I'm a PhD student. My main research area is privacy within internet social media. I worked a lot with end users. I interviewed them. We run focus groups. We have surveys. And what we're looking for is their attitudes and their behaviors towards privacy, and what do they care most regarding privacy, especially within internet and within social media. And what makes social media a very important topic is the amount of information that we share in social media, which is huge and makes it really concerns regarding privacy. And part of my research is also about developing tools that helps people to manage and control their privacy, and like privacy enhancing tools. I worked in different projects, Privacy Flag, USEMP, and I worked a little bit with F-Secure also to develop tools to enhance privacy within mobile phone. I'm going today to discuss about this project in the middle one, USEMP project, which was finished last year, and I'm going to present you the tool that we developed and what we did and what the tool was capable of. But just to set grounds about the importance of this topic and why are we here and why should we discuss this more in the society. One research came out last year, and it was about number of people which use social media. And number of adults and percentage of adults who really using social media is about 80% of them are using Facebook. And you can see the other social media, Instagram, Pinterest, LinkedIn, Twitter. So you can see the numbers are quite high, and people, a lot of people are on this social media. If I'm not mistaken, I think every day around 70 million photos are uploaded to Instagram. So that's a huge amount of data that we're sharing. And some say it's a gold mine for the companies to extract information about us. And not only we are in the social media, we are quite active in the social media. Like 80%, about 76% of people use like Facebook every day. It's the same with Instagram, 51% every day they use it. So then you can see it's very quite important to talk about this topic and what would really share and how does it impact our privacy. Another study in 2013 asked people if they think what kind of information about you can be found online, no matter if they did it themselves or someone else has done it, like if you share a photo of someone else on your Facebook. And 66 people says it's a photo. You can see the numbers there, and it the most interesting part is the political attitudes. Only 20% thought that they're sharing something about their political attitudes in the social media, which I would tell you later on how easy it is possible to infer someone's political attitude within social media just by looking at the data. And another study, they asked about who you're trying to avoid in the social media, especially hackers, advertisers. These are the people who people really don't want them to have access to our data. And you can see the government is in the lowest part. Concerns are quite high regarding using concerns about privacy within social media is quite high, and about 80% of people say that they are somehow concerned about the privacy and the third parties such as advertisers and government having access to what they share in social media. But before I start to talk about the use of information, both from the social media point of view and others like governments, security agencies, intelligence services, companies, It's important to see what information are collected actually, because if you collect something, store it, then it makes it possible to use it. I went through the privacy policy of Facebook and two of the most used services in the net, Google and Facebook. I went through the privacy policy and extracted what they say they collect from you when you use these services. Facebook collects whatever you do actually in when you interact with the service, what others do regarding you, if someone posts a photo of you, they use it, your networks, your connections, your friends, your device information, your location, and Facebook has what is called a network of advertisers, which they share information between themselves as well. So whatever it's collected from somewhere else which is connected to this network of Facebook companies, they can also have access to that one. I went through Google, it's the same more or less with Facebook. Information you give, whatever you search, they log information about your activities, your location, and things like that. And according to privacy policy is what they use this information for. Facebook uses to improve the services. This is what they stated. To develop or maybe new services, to communicate with you, show and measure ads and services, promote safety and security. For Google, it's somehow the same, to maintain, protect, provide new services or make your searches more kind of customizable. So whatever you search is different than one other person searches because they know your interest, so they kind of customize the searches towards your own interest. So they use this information for kind of giving you the search results, as they say, the better search results, and so on. So what is really missing here? They say explicitly what they collect, and they say what they use it for. But there is a gap between how they use this how they extract intelligence from the things that collected and used. So there is a gap between this collection and use, and what kind of technologies and how do they extract information and intelligence from the things that are collected. But if I want to give you some examples, real stories, if you step aside from the companies that use this information and think about the other examples and things that make it possible to use the information that we share. I went through some of the very interesting stories that consequences of the things that happened to some people. For instance, a teacher got fired from a school because she posted photos of her drinking alcohol, beer. And the thing was that she was in a vacation, in a Europe vacation, and she posted some photos of her having fun, basically. The school used this to fire her, to say this is inappropriate. But there is an ethical and moral question here. If she really knew that the school would use it in that way, would that she really done that? Yeah, we don't know. So who else can use this information? Burglars and thieves. If you post a photo of you having vacation in Spain or somewhere else, burglars use this information to come and rob you. And after this kind of news, insurance companies started to make new rules that if you share the location that you go, especially when you're vacation, which sends a signal to the burglars that your home is empty, they would start to reject your claims if you has house get robbed. So whatever we share have consequences over our life, as you can see. It was another story that the person loses benefit because of posting her photos. I'm not going to go into more detail about that. But the examples I made, the information that we share directly, that we say that we are on vacation, we say we are drinking or we are in a party. But the major issue with privacy is the fact that the information about the user may not appear in an explicit manner. It can extract it and it can be done in implicitly. So I can make you some examples. If a user is interested in college or educational issues, we can infer that that person is probably a young adult. Another example, in a dance club, people come together because they have the same interest, or in an office, people probably share the same profession. So what we can infer from this information is that someone's attributes can be extracted from their friends and from the networks that they have. And if you have a martini or cigarette in your hand with 98% of your photos, probably you will get liver failure, lung cancer, and lower life expectancy. So these are the things that could be inferred from the things that we share in the social media. I'm going to go through some of the things that the research has shown to be possible so far. In a study in 2013, they analyzed about 58,000 Facebook users on their likes and their information that they share in their Facebook. And with very high accuracy, they could easily infer the information about their ethnicity, the gender, if they're lesbian, it's a gay, you see the numbers, they're quite high. They could infer the religion of a person just by looking at likes and information that they share. So you don't really need to say that you're a Muslim. Just by looking at the information you have on Facebook, this information can be gathered. And I have very much more examples for you. 2013, with 92 accuracy, they could predict the gender by just looking at the status updates. In 2014, another study came out that they could see the marital status of a person. A sexual orientation of the person with very high accuracy by just looking at the friends of the person. Again, country, gender, political views. In 2010, they analyzed the Twitter messages, then they could predict the gender, age, regional origin, political affiliation by just looking at the Twitter messages. Again, Twitter messages, political views. Again, political views with 89% accuracy from the Twitter. And the list goes on. The literature is quite high number of these kind of studies that says it's very possible to do that, and it's the technology allows us to do that. And you can see that these things that are extracted are quite private things and very things that affects the privacy of ourselves. So regarding this kind of information, we started a project called USEMP, and in that project we developed a tool where we gave users more awareness about the things that could be inferred from their Facebook profiles. And I'm going to show you a very short video. It's about around 2 minutes, and it gives you some ideas about the project that we did and what we really did in that project.
DataBait is a web application that shows you what happens behind the screen, to the digital trail you leave behind when using services such as Facebook, Google, or Twitter. Ever wondered who's tracking you? What information could be extracted from your data? And how your profile appears through the looking glass? When using DataBait, you allow us to analyze items such as your Facebook posts, photos, and likes. By analyzing your data, we can make DataBait better for all future DataBait users. In return for your cooperation, you get to use DataBait and gain insight into what your personal data says about you, why that could be interesting to companies, and what you can do to take back control. We are very serious about handling your data in full compliance with EU data protection law. That is, in a secure, fair, and transparent way. That is why you sign a contract with us, a contract without complicated hidden clauses that informs you exactly about your rights, and you have quite a few of them. Please have a look at the contract again and the other information about the what, why, and how of Databate, because we believe that an informed user is an empowered user. Don't take the bait. Use Databate. Check us out.
So what the tool does is, upon the person registers to the service, it allows us to access to his Facebook profile. And by Facebook profile, I mean everything that they have done. Likes, photos, status updates, messages. Not the private messages, but the comments that they make. And what the tool does, it uses machine learning techniques and pattern recognition techniques to extract different information from the photos and everything that you share in Facebook. One feature of the tool was image mining tool, and what this feature does, it looks at the photo and extract the concepts from the photo. So for instance, if you give this photo to the algorithm, it gives back that this photo contains like a bicycle, it's a human there, it's a sky, it's mountains there, and so on. So probably by just looking at one picture, you can see a lot of things about that person. That this person is interested in bicycling, this is probably a sport person. And imagine if you have thousands of photos in Facebook and extract this kind of information, it gives a deal a lot of private information about ourselves. So what the tool does is looks at the photos that you have shared so far, extract these concepts, and the concepts that have been repeated a lot in throughout your profile, it shows to the users that, for instance, you have a lot of photos with beers in them. You have a lot of photos with Pilsner. And whenever the person clicks on the concepts, it shows all the photos that they have shared regarding that concept. And but just looking at the things that have been repeated a lot in your photos, it shows that probably you're a person that's interested in drinking, for instance. We also use the text mining techniques to extract the associate a text into a location. So for instance, if you have a status update that you are in Louvre Museum, it associates it to the Paris, for instance, that you have been in Paris. So it basically shows you all the cities that kind of could be inferred from whatever you write in Facebook. And the person can see the traces of the places that he or she has been into. Also, we used another feature that by using text mining and the photo mining tool that I just showed you, all these concepts that is gathered from the things that we share are classified in what we call them attributes. And the attributes will, a collection of attributes will represent a privacy dimension or a private part of our life. For instance, the concepts of cannabis, coffee, or alcohol could be related to your health, and so on. You can see we extracted around 96 different classified attributes, and as you have more information, and when you have more users using the system, because it's a machine learning technique, it will extract more attributes from the things that we share. So we only did one user study, and we extracted 96. So imagine if you have 1 million, you have a lot more attributes and more detailed things could be gathered. So we show to the user what they share about themselves regarding, for instance, hobbies, health, sexuality, psychology. And what the system does is extract the concepts and see what does it have effect on you. If, for instance, if you have a lot of photos with beer on them, it have effect on your consumer profile or health factors. So, for instance, people who live in USA, it might be interesting for them because they use insurance, for instance. So, if the insurance company have access to this kind of information, it might affect their insurance policy, for instance. And whenever the user clicks on a concept, on a privacy dimension, it breaks it down into lower level attributes. And we use something called the disclosure score. And the disclosure score is the confidence, how confident we are from our algorithm point of view that this information is accurate. How public or private this kind of information is, for instance, if you have shared it with public or with certain people. And also the sensitivity. And sensitivity is upon the user. User selects what information is sensitive for them. For instance, one person might not be really care about if the political attitudes is shared, but their health attitudes is not shared. So probably give it to a higher number sensitivity to health. So the system calculates the privacy score, and it will show to the user the things that could be inferred from their profile. And when they click on an attribute, it could be with high accuracy say that you are not sharing, for instance, in this photo, something about you smoking cannabis, for instance. And another example, for instance, the sexuality orientation. Another part of the tool shows the impact of people on your privacy. For instance, as I mentioned in the research that has been done so far, for instance, by just looking at the people's associations, it could be some attributes gathered from their, for instance, friends. So regarding this tool, we did a study in LTU. And what we did, we divided people into two groups. One group, we just showed them this tool, like what you are seeing right now. And in another group, we allowed them to use the tool and see what kind of different attitudes can be seen from comparing these two groups. And I gathered some interesting quotes from the participants when they used this tool. For instance, one person said that I was looking for a job recently and I was very careful about what others tag me or whatever I'm sharing on Facebook so that my future employer don't see this kind of information. And if I knew that this kind of tool would be available, then I would go back and see and delete the things that it's not okay for everyone else to see. Another person said that, for instance, Facebook has all kinds of crazy programs and algorithms that analyze your habits and likes and probably does worse than the developer of this tool. And they are a massive multinational company with billions of dollars. And this tool is just developed by some developers in Europe. Another person said that when you share your photos, you maybe share one or two or three photos and you kind of forget about the ones that you posted before. And when you see them all together, it can kind of summary of your personality and what kind of person you are and introducing yourself about yourself. So what was the result of this study? We could see that the attitudes change become stronger when we compare these two groups. The first group, when they just saw the tool and they just saw some screenshots of the tool, they made many affective responses. For instance, they said, "Oh, I'm scared. This is creepy," or they become somehow interesting into this topic. But the people who use this tool, they started to think more about what they share and what they are, what the traces they're leaving behind in their Facebook profile. So they could really think about the value of the information they share in social media, because Facebook, as I showed you in the privacy policy, use this kind of information for different purposes. And they could see that because I don't think anybody has ever paid anything to Facebook money-wise, but we use the service for free and we know that they have servers which cost a lot to run. So they extract information in from this kind of information that is beneficial for them. So people who use this tool really could see the value of the information they share from the service provider's point of view. And one interesting thing was that a lot of people could see that the things they share is a lot of concepts and a lot of inferences that could be gathered from the Facebook WhatsApp was because of the friends. Because the friends have shared something about them that could affect their privacy. So what was the conclusion of this talk today? The idea is that if in this project we could infer information, very private matters of life from looking at the Facebook profile and using different techniques to gather information, then probably others can do that. And we used it to aware people, make awareness within the society and within the people who use Facebook, for instance, or other kind of social media to learn about what they disclose and what they share and be more careful about that, because people and computers might interpret our information differently. And my intention was not really to scare you as you first introduced, but to give you more awareness and just to maybe look and think twice about what you share and maybe seek for there are different tools that could help you in order to manage and control your privacy. Very small programs you can install on your browser that could help you to somehow give you more awareness and give you control about the privacy. And the question remains that is it only enough to be aware that what will happen to our data, or should we make changes maybe to our own attitudes towards constant sharing of everything? And by that, I would like to thank you for listening, and I would like to also thank Soy for inviting me here to discuss about my research. Also, I would like to say that we are currently recruiting citizen scientists, as we call them, to help us develop the future of technology. And my colleagues here are happy to help you if you're interested in that. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ali. Before I open for discussions or questions, I would like to know, if I would participate and give you access to my Facebook for this project, for how long would you use that access? Right now or forever or what?
Since the project is finished, we don't have legally rights to do that anymore, because what we did was kind of a secondary use, and we're processing information, which is something right now we can't do it right now. But when we had the project, we were only allowed to have this data in our database after only 3 months the project finished. So right now we erased everything from our database. And because when the people use this service, they, as you saw in the video, they signed a contract with us that it somehow allowed us to process their information. Right now there is no such a contract. So the tool doesn't work right now in that way.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. If there are anyone else who has something to ask or some remarks or something, just raise your hand and I will come out with a microphone so everyone can hear you. And if you want to ask your question in Swedish, that's all right, we'll translate it.
Hello, Ali. We are colleagues at university, though I don't previously know in depth your research. you basically enlightened us about what can be concluded from data you are sharing voluntarily. I mean, more or less, you are aware when you upload a picture, etc. But I think there is an area of information which you're not aware that we actually share. Mm. For instance, when we are browsing and using our browsers, there are cookies stored, which can be read by any software to conclude things about our surfing. But my question is more into the domain of using the information to actually change the reality you're facing. I have an example where I self-surfed on machine learning. And when I did so, an advertisement appeared from Google, recruiting people in machine learning, actually held in Luleå. And I called up Google in Luleå and checked, do you have an announcement for that? They didn't know about it. So that was an announcement totally machine generated based on my browsing and my search abilities. And the thought here is that maybe each individual's appreciation of reality will be different, depending at least through the network and through the media. So I'd just like you to comment on that, what you can see in the future about our appreciation, how reality is appearing and maybe be changed due to our own situation and our own kind of personality.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. The thing with privacy is that it's quite vast and quite different for different people, and different people see it differently. But the thing is that when this information is used, it's not communicated to its users. So if they use it in certain ways, because it might affect the way that you disclose this information. If you knew that it's used in certain ways, then you have probably might not wanted to share it in the first place. So I think the battle is, I mean, the power relation now it's more towards the companies and data holders, because they have more power over our own information, and they have more. Users have fragmented views on their own things that they share. So I think this needs to be shifted a bit towards the end users, so that they make more informed decisions about their disclosures. So this is my kind of way of looking at it.
Any more questions? Any remarks, comments? Yes.
Hello. You can read now and then that the government and authorities want to take, and wish to take more and more control over the media. What do you think in the future? Do you think the government will take more control, or will it be free as it is today?
At least in US it is going that way. Like, Trump just signed up and canceled some of the privacy protection mechanisms that has been in order by Obama's administration, at least. In US, I would say they would have more control. And in the past, we saw that the NSA, for instance, gained access to a lot of social media information without even Facebook knowing that. So they kind of hacked into their system. So even if they don't mention it that they have, it's a possibility still to gain this information without the social media companies, without them really knowing that. So if you are going in that direction, it's just a guess by me only. I would say yes, but I hope it doesn't go that way.
Anyone else? Yes?
I was interested also about the telecom companies here in Sweden and in EU or in the world, in a global scale, and then about the computer applications as an example in related to Facebook. They have access to all information in general and how they can then use it. Have you been interested and researching related to policies and the development somewhere else except in the USA?
The thing is that we don't, at least I don't really know what Facebook uses. We know what they use it for, but we don't really know how they extract this information, and are they really going deep down into our very private matters of our lives? I don't know about that really, but we know that the searches and the advertisements are more accurate right now, which means that they have algorithms that with a great deal of accuracy that they can predict about our interest and our hobbies. So it's quite customized things that we see in our profiles. They're coming from somewhere, and it's high probability that they have this kind of technologies.
One last final question from me. You talked about changing our own attitudes. What do you think is most important of that, in that?
First, we need to see that what are the consequences of the things that we share. It might not have an impact right now, but in the future, in 10 years, when the technology is more mature, maybe they can extract more things that we can't do right now. I mean, we do things today which was not possible 10 years ago. And the thing with social media and with the internet is that everything is kind of stored somewhere and it's available throughout time, and later on maybe it's so maybe just raise our awareness about these issues. So think a bit, twice before we share something that's if it has a consequence in the future. Because privacy attitude changes throughout time also.
I think we will stop here right now for today. We have a small amount of time left, but I think that if there's anyone who wants to talk with Ali in person, you are welcome to come forward to do that. I would like first to thank you for this talk, and then I would like to present what's coming tomorrow and next week here in the house. Thank you for taking your time. Thank you for making the effort, and thank you for being a part of this, the concept Vetenskapens Hus, sharing knowledge, be a part of raising awareness with the help of our knowledge and with the help of the research we develop. On behalf of the university, I would like to thank you very much.
Thank you for inviting me. Thanks a lot.